Amen. Like that positive faith there, brother. This morning I want to share with you to be an example to the believer. Paul took a young man under his wings
and began to teach him some of the characteristics and the traits of the ministry. And Paul began to give wise advice. Men, today you need to be taking somebody under your wing and be giving wise advice to them about Jesus and what Jesus can do and how Jesus, you can project that onto others. As a father, you need to be bringing up your sons and your daughters in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. You know, you'll probably hear this maybe two or three times during the message this morning, but what one generation allows in moderation, the next generation will allow in excess. And that's what's happened. Many in your generation here this morning did not teach you in the ways of the Lord, did not bring you up to fear and the admonition of the Lord. And we begin to find that when that happens, that next generation takes it to an excess. And I have shared with you before, I'm concerned about our next generation of young people that are coming up, because many of them are not catching what Jesus wants to do in their life. And when we fail to tell them, and we fail to live the example before them, they have no hope. Since COVID-19 has hit, I heard a statistic the other day that said that suicide rate among our young people has risen over 20% because they have no value. I want you to know this morning, you have value. You have purpose. God has purposed your life. He did not make a mistake when He made you. He did not make a mistake when He called you to be a son or a daughter. Every man, woman, and child that God has made has purpose. And it's our obligation and responsibility to teach that. I look at our parents today, and many parents today, grandmas and grandpas, are raising their children. Grandmas and grandpas, you still have purpose. God has a special calling and a special anointing and a special message that you need to get to your sons and your daughters and your grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Stay in there faithful and committed to Jesus Christ. Show them by examples what it is to be a born-again believer. I want to pick up here in 1 Timothy, the 4th chapter, with verse 12. And you know I use this scripture quite a bit, but it's one that I really love. Let no one despise your youth. Be an example to the believer in word, in conduct, in love, in spirit, in faith, in purity. Till I come, give attention to reading, exhortation, doctrine. Do not neglect the gift that is in you, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of hands and of the eldership. Meditate on these things, give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them, for For in doing this, you will save both yourself and those that hear you. Your message is important. Be sure today that you're living God's message. Let your light shine that other men may see God and glorify the Father which is in heaven. But when we live in sin, and people, we live in sin. God has set us free, but we endanger and we involve ourselves in coming back. Watch your kids. You know, more is caught than is taught. Your kids see you. But do they see you praying? Do they see you reading the Word? Studying the Word? Sharing the Word? What does God want of me? What is my purpose? What is your purpose? Tally, if I would ask you this morning, I'm going to put some of you guys on the spot this morning, and I know you just cringe when I do that, but if I was to ask you, what is your purpose this morning? Huh? Play on the congas. What's your big purpose? Play on the congas. You know what? That is a part of the gift that God has given to him. And praise God, he's doing that. But this morning, God has a purpose for you. When God created Adam and Eve, he did not make a mistake. God has not made a mistake with you. If he created you male, he created you male. If he created you female, he created you female. He did not make a mistake. Satan wants to lie to you and tell you you're a mistake. And many of us have bought that we're a mistake. God, you don't have a purpose for me. Why am I here? God, you're here because God placed you here and he gave you a responsibility. And he sees what you can become. You know, that's one of the things in coaching that Pam would look at me and she says, how do you see potential in somebody? And that's a unique gift that God has given to me. Because I've had some kids on my teams that I've had parents come up and say, well, those kids can't play basketball. Those kids can't play football. I said, yeah, they can. But you have to bring it out of them. I've told you about the team that I had that everybody said, these kids can't play. They're no good. They have no knowledge. They have no abilities. And I said, yes, they do. And God gave me this, what they called the throwaway team, because nobody wanted these girls. And we took those girls and we taught them and trained them and worked with them, encouraged them that they could be something. I had one of the little girls came to me and says, nobody wants me. My grandma and my mom and my dad, they don't want me. My grandma and grandpa, they don't want me. I'm from the other side of the tracks. Nobody wants me. And I can tell you what, I wanted to take that little girl home with me. That little girl could be in the WNBA today. She was that good. But nobody wanted her on their basketball team. So when God takes those kind of people, God has a purpose for them. You know what? That young girl started playing. And those girls came together. And we had a lot of teams that gathered around to watch this throwaway team because they weren't going to be able to do anything. They weren't going to be able to beat anybody. They couldn't even dribble a basketball. But you know what? When his team came together and they found purpose and they found goal in their life, That team never lost a game. That team began to play together. It only takes one person. It only takes you encouraging that young man or that young woman to become something in Christ. I'd have coaches come to me and say, "How did you get that girl to play for you? She wouldn't play for me." I said, "I encouraged her. I told her she was somebody. And God, I told her that God had a purpose for her." When the coach gathered all the teams around in the gymnasium and watched our team play, he recruited, now these were fourth grade girls, he recruited five of my players to play in high school. She says, "I want these kids on my team when they get to high school." You know what? It just takes encouragement. Dads, it takes encouragement from you guys. You encourage your son or daughter or stepson or stepdaughter. You encourage them in the Lord. In Deuteronomy, it brings out in Deuteronomy the sixth chapter, how do we encourage? How do we teach? How do we train? In Deuteronomy the sixth chapter, it tells us here to look. And let's look it up here. When Moses was teaching them, and in the sixth chapter, beginning in verse 1, "Now this is the commandment, and these are the statutes and judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach, that you may observe them in the land which you're crossing over to possess, that you may fear the Lord your God, to keep all of his statutes and his commandments, which I command you today. And your sons and your grandsons all the days of their life, that their days may be prolonged." And then he goes jumping down to verse 6 there. "And these are the words which I command you today, that you shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and there shall be as a frontlet between thine eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and of your gates." How do we teach them? We teach them. You talk of it when you're in your house. You talk of it when you come together. You talk of it when they lay down. You talk of it when they raise up. You begin to talk about it. What do our families talk about today? They don't talk. I think God sent COVID along just so that families would talk to one another. That we would become social. We would become people of communication. God wants us to communicate. Why do most marriages break up? Because there's a lack of communication. We fail to talk to one another. We're quick to blame one another. We're quick to charge one another. But we won't sit down and we won't talk it out and we won't discuss it. And all of a sudden it begins, what began as a little splinter explodes into a mountain of division and strife. Same thing happens with your children. Fathers, talk to your kids. Now, some of us are going to say, "But I failed." Begin where you're at today. Water under the bridge is awful hard to retrieve. But you can begin where you're at today. I know kids, I sit down the other day and I was listening to a father and son talk. And the father, he was talking and he was blaming this person for something that had gone on in their life. And he blamed this person and blaming that person and blaming somebody else. And I thought, oh my gosh. And his son was sitting right there and his son opened his mouth and began to speak. And he was blaming this person for something and blaming somebody else for something and blaming somebody else for something. And I thought, what is being passed down from father to son? That same spirit. When you come to know Jesus Christ, if you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, begin to share. Get the old junk out of your life and begin to share what Jesus is putting in there. Replace the old with the new. He wants to put new wine in these old wineskins. He wants us to begin to change our characteristic and our thoughts and our actions and our deeds. He wants us to begin to put the life that we want our children to live. You know, sometimes I am very grateful. I grew up in a good family. Many times I look back on my past and I begin to see my dad hated sports. My dad was a farmer. Our place was to be on the farm, not on a sports field. You know, sports today, they always took it out when it was chore time. Dad didn't like that. Dad didn't like sports. But you know what? Even when my dad didn't like sports, when it came game time, I could show you on the bleachers where Dad sat. I could show you when I played basketball on the bleachers where my dad sat, was there, and he slept through the game. You would watch him, if he was watching him very close, he'd put his hand under here, and every time he'd go to sleep, he'd go, whoa. And he did that quite often during the games. He didn't like it, but you know what? He loved me enough to be there. That's all our kids need. Your kids, you need to know Dad loves them enough to be there. Did my dad ever tell me I did a good job? No. But he was there, and that was enough for me. My junior and senior year of high school, my dad, even though he didn't like sports, they started traveling to games. And to me, that was exciting as all get out. You know, Dad hated sports. Didn't want to have anything to do with them. Told me growing up, you're not going to play sports. You're not going to be involved in sports. I guess I rebelled as a son because I love sports. I wanted to be there, and I was there. But he was there with me. And that's an important aspect. Proverbs 22:6 says, train up a child in the way that they should go. Dads, I don't want to beat a dead horse here this morning. You may have failed in the beginning, but since you've come to know Jesus Christ, succeed. Share the love of Jesus. Share the transformation in your life. And let them see. I had a young friend who, his dad was very abusive to him. And he couldn't see any good in his dad. His dad, later years in life, came to know the Lord and began to let the Word of God transform his life. And I can remember this dad going to his son and saying, son, I failed as a father when you was growing up. I only knew what I had been taught. And he said, I gave my life to Christ a couple of years ago. And I'm reading a book and it's teaching me. And I'm going to ask you, son, will you forgive me? Because I didn't know. And I watched that father-son relationship begin to grow. I'm going to show you a clip here in just a moment from Courageous. How many of you have seen Courageous? Okay. Those of you who haven't seen Courageous, I will challenge you to get the video. We may even have a film night one night, and I'm going to show it. But in this film clip, they're taking a resolution. And I know it's going to be kind of hard to jump in, but I want you to understand here that these five men that are going to take this resolution were men who decided that they were going to follow Jesus. Every one of them made mistakes in their lives. Some of them went to prison. Some of them made mistakes by not doing stuff with their children. Some of them, are we ready? Is it ready? Okay. I'm going to have Megan play this first clip. There's two clips. We're going to play the first one, then I'm going to talk a little bit more, and then we will see.
I can't tell you. What an honor this is for me today to hear the commitment that you men are making for your faith and your families was almost overwhelming. Nathan, I'd like for you to come and stand before me and your wife and children to stand beside me. My son in the faith, I took joy in mentoring you as a young man. And today, I take joy in blessing you as a godly father. Are you ready to make this commitment before God and your family?
Yes, I am.
Then I'd like for you to repeat after me. I, Nathan Hayes, do solemnly resolve before God.
I, Nathan Hayes, do solemnly resolve before God.
To take full responsibility for myself, my wife, and my children.
That I would take full responsibility for myself, my wife, and my children.
I will love them, protect them, and serve them.
I will love them, protect them, and serve them.
And teach them the statutes of God as the spiritual leader of my home.
And teach them the statutes of God as the spiritual leader of my home.
I will be faithful to my wife, to love and honor her.
I'll be faithful to my wife, to love and honor her.
And be willing to lay down my life for her as Christ did for me.
And be willing to lay down my life for her as Christ did for me.
I will teach my son to love God with all of his heart, all of his mind, and all of his strength.
I will teach my son to love God with all of his heart, all of his mind, and all of his strength.
And I will train him to honor authority and live responsibly.
I will train him to honor authority and to live responsibly.
I will confront evil, pursue justice, and love mercy.
I will treat others with kindness, respect, and compassion.
I will work diligently, provide for the needs of my family.
I will forgive those who have wronged me and reconcile with those who I have wronged.
I will walk in integrity as a man answerable to God.
I will seek to honor God, obey His word, and do His will.
As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Now that each of you has committed to live by this resolution, I bless you in the name of the Lord. But I also have a warning for each of you. Now that you know what you are to do and have committed to do it before God and these witnesses, you are doubly accountable. Let me also assure you that you may have confidence in this resolution and your resolve now, because as you stand here, there's no challenge, no controversy, and no conflict. But I can assure you that challenges will arise, conflicts will arise, and controversy will arise. It is at that moment that in order to live out this resolution, you will need courage. Courage, courage.
When you make that commitment in your life, when you committed yourself to be a born-again believer, there are going to be challenges that come into your life. And it's going to take courage. It's going to take strength. It's going to take commitment and dedication. The Apostle Paul, as he was writing here, he told young Timothy, said, be an example unto the believers. Church, today you need to be an example of the believers and to the believers and to the world in which we live in. He said to do it in speech. Our words, our vocabularies need to be speech that are honorable unto the Lord. They need to be speeches that project Jesus as Lord of your life. Our conduct, our manner of life. See, our world has lost the concept of what life is all about. 30% of the suicides that are happening right now, people have no purpose of life. God created you with purpose in your life. And today, the church is standing in the gap. Jesus is standing in the gap. Many of us have made mistakes in our lives. If I could go on and tell you about the rest of this, even all these men here, even though they made a resolution, when that time came, each one of them faced something in their life. You're going to face something in your life. But are you living for Jesus? We have a saying today, son, you do as I say, not as I do. You need to live, if you want your son to do what you're doing, practice it in front of him. But I can tell you what, when you begin to be a born-again believer, you need to begin to get this word into your heart and into your life and begin to live. God gave us principles of life. Many of us, I've said in many counseling situations and said, hey, I don't want my son to be that way. Then dad, quit being that way. Rise up. God is calling you to be an example. I've had fathers sit in my office and say, my sons won't go to church. And I asked them, I said, did you go to church? Did you lead your sons into church? And they said, no, I didn't. How can you expect your sons to go to church if you didn't go to church? In our home, my dad didn't give you an option. He said, when you graduate from high school and you're out on your own, you get to make the choice. But when you're in my house, and we have many people today who let the kids run the house and not mom and dad, and they get to make the decisions. We don't need to let the kids make the decisions. You're the parent. You make the decisions. You raise them up. You teach them. You train them. It's awful hard for mom to override dad. Or dad to override mom. It has to be an agreement. Come together. Minister together. Work together. But moms and dads, that's where you have to set the example. I wrote this down. Today we have replaced the Bible with cell phones, TVs, computer games, and secular humanism. We tell our kids to do as I say and not as I do. I'm appalled, and I know that it's the trend of our time, but I'm still appalled today when you hand a 18-month-old a cell phone. And that child, and that replaces mom and dad in their lives. Why are our kids in jail and in prison today? They didn't have mom. They didn't have dad. They have cell phones, computer games. They want to hear your voice, mom, dad. They want to hear your voice. They want to hear your instructions. They want to see your examples. And today probably sounds like pastors beating us up. I'm not trying to beat us up. I'm just saying we have to take a stand. Church, God has called you. God has set you there as an example. God has given you a challenge. God wants us to do. Be thou an example to the believer in word, in deed, in conduct, in speech, in pattern of life. What you're doing is what your child will do. I am so thankful. My dad taught me, you will be in the house of the Lord on Sunday. Now, some of you could look at that and say that's good, and some of you can look at that and say it's bad. But you know what? I stand behind the pulpit today because God taught me, and my dad taught me faithfulness, dedication, commitment. And Jesus got a hold of my life and wanted me to challenge you here in 2020. So, fathers, you need to have dedication, faithful commitment. We can look back at our past and we can blame mom or dad for how we are today. That's true. But you are the man that can set it straight. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You set the example. When God comes in and He begins to change the heart, He's going to revolutionize. You know, one of the hardest things we ask, I remember one time, and I'm not going to prolong a whole lot here, but I can remember one time. I looked at my son and said, "Son, I want you to forgive me. I have never been a dad before." And I corrected him about something, and I don't even remember what it was now. And I said, "To the best of my ability, this is what I see from the Scripture, what God wants me to do." And you know what? I'm so thankful today that all three of my children are in the house of the Lord, serving Jesus and living for God. Church, we have to rise up. We may have made mistakes. Let the mistakes be made. But start where you're at here this morning. I want you to listen to this last clip. Start where you're at here this morning and let Jesus be the Lord of your life.
For the last 6 weeks, I've preached on God's design for fathers, to be teachers, to be protectors, to be providers. I read to you this resolution that was written and signed by the four men standing behind me. But instead of just talking about these men, I'm going to ask Adam Mitchell to come and speak to us.
As a law enforcement officer, I've seen firsthand the deep hurt and devastation that fatherlessness brings in a child's life. Our prisons are full of men and women who have lived recklessly after being abandoned by their fathers, wounded by the men who should have loved them the most. Many of these children now follow the same pattern of irresponsibility that their fathers did. While so many mothers have sacrificed to help their children survive, they were never intended to carry the weight alone. We thank God for them. But research is proving that a child also desperately needs a daddy. There's no way around this fact. As you know, earlier this year, my family endured the tragic loss of our 9-year-old daughter, Emily. Her death forced me to realize that not only had I not taken advantage of the priceless time I had with her, but that I did not truly understand how crucial my role was as a father to her and our son, Dylan. Since her passing, I've asked God to show me through His Word how to be the father that I need to be. I now believe that God desires for every father to courageously step up and do whatever it takes to be involved in the lives of his children. But more than just being there, providing for them, he's to walk with them through their young lives and be a visual representation of the character of God, their Father in heaven. The father should love his children and seek to win their hearts. He should protect them, discipline them, and teach them about God. He should model how to walk with integrity and treat others with respect. And should call out his children to become responsible men and women who live their lives for what matters in eternity. Some men will hear this and mock it or ignore it. But I tell you that as a father, you are accountable to God for the position of influence he has given you. You can't fall asleep at the wheel, only to wake up one day and realize that your job or your hobbies have no eternal value, but the souls of your children do. Some men will hear this and agree with it, but have no resolve to live it out. Instead, they will live for themselves and waste the opportunity to leave a godly legacy for the next generation. But there are some men who, regardless of the mistakes we've made in the past, regardless of what our fathers did not do for us, will give the strength of our arms and the rest of our days to loving God with all that we are and to teach our children to do the same. And whenever possible, to love and mentor others who have no father in their lives, but who desperately need help and direction. And we are inviting any man whose heart is willing and courageous to join us in this resolution. In my home, the decision has already been made. You don't have to ask who will guide my family, because by God's grace, I will. You don't have to ask who will teach my son to follow Christ, because I will. Who will accept the responsibility of providing and protecting my family? I will. Who will ask God to break the chain of destructive patterns in my family's history? I will. Who will pray for and bless my children to boldly pursue whatever God calls them to do? I am their father. I will. I accept this responsibility, and it is my privilege to embrace it. I want the favor of God and His blessing on my home. Any good man does. So where are you, men of courage? Or are you fathers who fear the Lord? It's time to rise up and answer the call that God has given to you and to say, I will. I will. I will.
This is a call. I can't watch it without crying, I'm sorry. But this is a call. We need men who will stand up and say, I will. It's good for a mother, but it's great for a father to stand and say, I will lead my family. Don't let the kids tell you they're going to stay home. We have but a few short days in our children's lives to make a lasting impression. As a pastor, as a father of this congregation, my heart cry goes out to every one of you. We've all made mistakes. We've all failed at some point. But I'm asking you today to start where you're at and begin to live your life in a pattern. Paul took Timothy under his arm. I'm asking you to take somebody under your arm and say, hey, this is what we're going to do. And this is what I want to be for the Lord. And this is what I want you to be, a son or a daughter for the Lord. Let's stand together. Father, you see every man, every woman, and every child here today. Father, I'm asking, particularly for these men, that they hear the heart's cry of the children. When Moses told them, Lord, for them to talk of it when they rise up and when they lie down and when they walk by the way, Father, help us to resolve our differences. Help us to apply your word and say, I will follow Jesus and lead my family, my sons, my grandsons, my daughters, my granddaughters, into the house of the Lord to worship and into a personal relationship with Jesus. Father, this morning we cry out unto you and say, thank you, Father, for loving us, that you sent us your Son, Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth should not perish but have everlasting life. And Father, that's what we need today, is our relationship restored with you. No matter what mistakes we've made, no matter where we've fallen short, God, you can bring restoration and healing and cleansing to each and every life here. And I pray this morning, Father, if there's one here that needs to come to know you as Lord and Savior of their life, Father, that you will let them step out and walk forth and say, I want my life to be placed in the hands of Jesus, that he be my pilot and my guide. And Father, we thank you for that. Start where you're at today, friends. Start where you're at today. No matter what that past life was, no matter what that past life has been, when you come to know Jesus, start it today with a relationship with Jesus. Father, we thank you. You see those that have raised their hands this morning that have taken or are beginning to take another step with you. Encourage them, strengthen them, build them, help them to walk with you. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen.